In this video, we'll be discussing Grover's algorithm, a quantum search algorithm. Let's begin by introducing different types of search problems. So there's optimization problems, such as finding the most efficient route to deliver packages, identification, such as machine learning classification algorithms, and one-way functions, where there's a solution that's hard to find, but easy to verify. We'll dive a little bit more in depth with one-way functions. There are many different types of problems that have the characteristic of being hard to calculate, but easy to verify. So Sudoku, factoring, and optimization all fall into this category. Grover's algorithm is efficient at solving these types of problems, especially because they have limited structure. And what does that mean whenever there's limited structure in the solution space? That means that one wrong guess doesn't necessarily give you any information about what the correct answer is. If we were thinking about the best way to solve these types of problems with a classical algorithm, we would have to implement a brute force search or an exhaustive search. Let's think of a simple example of a search problem. We'll pick a random number between 1 and 100, and there's only one correct answer. An incorrect guess doesn't provide any information about what the correct answer is. So if we have 100 different values that we could be thinking of, in the worst case, we would have 99 calls to our classical oracle in order to find the solution, the number that we picked. So this is an example of an unstructured search. We don't get any information from previous guesses about what the correct solution is. In the worst case, we would have to take big O to the N times to locate an item within this database of size N, with N being the number of items that we're searching through. If random access and pre-sort were added to implement a binary search on ordered data, our search time would reduce, but these sorting procedures don't come for free. They still require some time to implement. So here we introduce a quantum solution, Grover's algorithm. Grover's algorithm was developed in 1996, and it is applicable to any problem that can be solved classically by a random brute force search. It's a major algorithm proposed for quantum computing, and it's probably one of the most popular, right behind Shor's algorithm. So how does Grover's algorithm work? Grover's algorithm takes advantage of qubit superposition and phase interference to improve unstructured database search from big O n to big O square root of n. But what does that big O mean? Big O notation on a very high level means that it's the upper bound of the amount of time or memory that an algorithm needs to come up with a solution. So in the example of choosing a random number between 1 and 100, 99 attempts at worst case classically would become square root of 100 or 10 circuit runs in the quantum case. This is a quadratic speedup. We can look at this chart over here. We see that we have n reduced to square root of n. Amplitude amplification is one of the key components of Grover's algorithm that allows it to work. So what does this do? This allows us to increase the probability of observing the correct answer or the object of search. So we want to increase the probability amplitude associated with the answer ket while simultaneously decreasing all other probability amplitudes. So if we have a balanced superposition and we're looking for a particular value, let's say ket 1, 1, we're going to boost ket 1, 1's probability amplitude while reducing all other basis ket probability amplitudes. And as a note, we can see that the math checks out that all of these probabilities will still sum to 1 that are associated with this state. What is the procedure for amplitude amplification? We want to start with that balanced superposition, and we want to assign a phase of -1 to that chosen ket. So in our example, ket 1, 1. So drawn out, we have our probability amplitudes. We're going to assign a negative phase to our chosen ket, so ket 1, 1. We're going to call the matrix that implements the phase flip U of F. Once we have our inverted phase, we're going to invert all amplitudes around the mean or average. So if we take the average of all of our probability amplitudes, you'll get 0.25. We have labeled 0.25 or 1/4. And we're going to invert all of our amplitudes around the mean. We see that all of our other kets go to 0 and our ket of search, ket 1, 1, goes to 1. We will call the matrix that inverts around the mean U of phi. Let's take a second to do a little practice problem. In the previous example, what matrix could we use for that oracle that assigns phase of -1 to the chosen ket? It would be D. So we want to assign a -1 phase to ket 1, 1. You can try this out by multiplying this matrix with different 2-qubit vectors. Amplitude amplification has two parts. There's the diffusion operation that inverts amplitudes around the mean, and then there's the oracle that flips the sign of the desired search element, so it assigns that phase of negative one. But there's a lingering question. How does the oracle know what to look for? At a high level, we're going to describe how to build this oracle. So we want to develop a classical function, we'll call this f of x, that outlines our search criteria. So f of x will equal one when x is the solution. We have to outline criteria such as find an input x that's a factor of 25, starting with these numbers, find an arrangement of a 9 by 9 grid, or the Sudoku problem, find the optimum route where I visit 300 stops only once. So we take all these and outline criteria where f of x is equal to zero if input x does not satisfy the criteria, but it's equal to one if x, the input, does satisfy the criteria. Next, we want to create a reversible circuit that calculates f of x with input x. Remember, we previously discussed how we can use different tools like Ancilla to create reversible functions out of irreversible functions. Once we have a reversible circuit generated, we add an additional Ancilla with negative phase that introduces phase kickback when f of x is equal to one. That allows our object of search to get a phase of negative one. So here we see our Ancilla with negative phase. If f of x is equal to one, phase kickback occurs. Remember, we learned about phase kickback in previous lectures. Now that we know how to construct the oracle and the main components of Grover's search, we'll talk about the mechanics. So we identify our search problem and the data are n total items that we wish to search. Then we find the smallest number of n that satisfies n is less than or equal to 2 to the little n. Our input x will be represented with n qubits in the search algorithm, and we'll put all those qubits into superposition so we can look at all these values at once. We'll construct our oracle that will flip the sign of the object of search, and our gate, u of f, that flips the sign of the object of search, and then we'll run u of f followed by u of phi, our Grover's diffusion operator, square root of n times. So we can see that here. Then we measure and read off the state with an encoding that corresponds to the desired item in the database. Additional notes for Grover's algorithm include the following. There are a few ways to implement the Grover Oracle F, but the mechanics for the search process stay the same. We searched for one item here, but there are variations of Grover's algorithm that can search for multiple database targets. So if we have the case where we're looking for T possible matches, the oracle is repeated square root of N divided by T times. There's also the ability to do partial quantum search. So an example of this would be determining if a student's final grade follows into a certain percentile without caring about the exact ranking of that student.